Well, good morning. Yeah, let's get rolling this morning. Y'all stand, let's get into some worship.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love for me. This battle against the world, but only those who believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I'm chosen this morning. I'm chosen. Thank you.
awesome. Hey, have a seat if you would. We are so glad that you are here. Yeah, you're a child of God. There's a place in our Father's house for you eternally, but also here at Park Avenue. I'm Jimmy Towson, senior pastor here. We're so excited that you guys are here. Speaking of a place for you, we have another awesome family that is coming today to take their next step. Where are the Purvises? You guys want to come on up? Are they around? Yes, here they are. A lot of you folks will know Jake and Tara Purvis, and they are coming with John Everett and Truett to take this next step. I just love it. Come on up, guys. Wonderful, wonderful. Yeah, come on up. Good to be on the big stage. How about that? Good. All right, so they've decided to take their next step. You guys have seen us do this before. We always ask two questions. The first question is this: do you reaffirm your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? And will you support this church with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? Yes, sir. There you go. You are now officially members of Park Avenue United Methodist Church. Yeah, absolutely. Love you guys. I'm so happy to have you. Thank you so much. Y'all make sure you welcome them as you see them during the greeting time. I want to tell you about a few other things that are happening. First thing is this, blood drive this coming Wednesday. We need your help filling out spots there. We are always very generous with the support that we have for our Red Cross. So please come and support that this Wednesday. There's something for our senior adults, but you may want to take a part in this if you are interested. I think it's a great thing. We're going to have a class called Scam Me If You Can. And it's a class designed to help avoid being scammed with all the stuff that's out there these days. So if you're interested in that, classes will start on February the 6th at 2:30 in the afternoon. I want to remind you that IF Gathering is coming up on February the 7th and 8th. That's quickly approaching. And then a big, big, big event is Lisa Harper. That is Sunday, March the 15th. We've got 250 or so signed up so far. Spaces are tight, so make sure you get in there and sign up if you would. It's going to be a great Sunday evening with Lisa Harper, a very super gifted speaker. So we are so glad you're here. Would you remember to fill out your communication card and drop it in the offering basket when it comes around? I want to tell you this. Listen, another hard sermon today. That's okay, because when they're hard, there also means there's a solution. And today we're going to be talking about rejection, so get ready. And also be ready for some healing to start today. So glad you're here. Stand up and greet those around you as we continue to worship together.
And oh, come forward, we'll go ahead and get ready to take up our offering. And I want to remind the kids while we're waiting on them to get up here that after this next song is when you leave and go to Children's Church. If you look on the screens, it'll give you ways that you can give electronically, or you can put it in the basket as it comes by. Don't forget to fill your slip out and drop it in there. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much, Lord, that you are here, that you are in this place, and that you love us. God, I pray that you would bring to our mind as we listen this morning, as we hear, as we take your word in, all the many ways that you have accepted us and that you have loved us. Lord, I pray that as we give back to you this morning, that it would be an outpouring unto you of all that you have given unto us. In Jesus' name, amen.
From wherever you've been, come broken heart, let our rescue begin. And come find your mercy, oh sinner, come near. This earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal. And earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal. So lay down your burden.
you pray with me? God, I pray the power, the name of Jesus Christ, with the hope and the presence of the Holy Spirit, God, that you move in this place. And that your holy conviction brings brokenness for the sake of justification. Brokenness for the sake of healing. For God, that you begin to break down the walls and barriers in our life that we place up to protect from ourselves, protect from the world outside, but God, in most cases, it protects us or hinders us from you. And so I pray as we just sang, thought, prayed, that you want us to come as we are. God, that we come as the broken, sinful creatures that we have become. God, that you begin to make us and shape us and trim us and grow us into the creation that you intended for all along. For God, that's what the power of the gospel does. That's what the Holy Spirit does at work inside of us as we draw close to you. So this morning, in the quietness of the space, God, let us feel your presence. Let us not stop ourselves from being close to you. God, may you do a work, a new work in us this morning. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to Seeing 2020. And now for your host, Patrick Carlson.
Today, thanks to electronic communications, social media platforms, and dating apps, each of us is connected to thousands of people, any of whom might ignore our posts, chats, texts, or dating profiles and leave us feeling rejected. Other rejections are more serious. From job loss to family separation, rejection is painful. As recently as 2015, science has shown that rejection and pain register in the same part of our brain, generating the exact same mental feeling. Whether the rejection we experience is large or small, one thing remains constant. It always hurts. And it usually hurts more than we expect. This morning, in our investigation, we look into why rejection continues to hurt, where we can find true healing, and how the right perspective can see rejection recede in our life. I'm Patrick Carlson, and this is Seeing 2020.
Yeah, so rejection. Here's the thing that may happen today as you're listening to this message. It may conjure up some feelings of rejection that you've experienced over your life. One of two things will happen. Either you're going to be in a place where you're going to say, praise God that he has healed me of that sense of rejection that I had from whatever it was for so long. Or you may say, why did you bring that up? Why did you make me think about that again? And if that's you, here's the beauty of what you're going to hear today from the Lord. You're not healed yet, but you can be. And so rejection is one of those things that it just seems to grab a hold of us, and it stays with us, and it tells us all kinds of things about ourselves that simply aren't true. So I want to start with some scripture today from Ephesians. It's in chapter 1. It's just two verses. And this is the heart of who God is and what he thinks about us. So listen to these words. Verse 5, God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure. So we praise God for the glorious grace he has poured out on us who belong to his dear Son. beautiful passage about God's love for us. Now, let me just ask you, I'm going to have to bring up those memories. You ever been rejected before? You ever been rejected? Listen, when I was in high school, I may have mentioned this shortly after I came, I had one event that stands out in my mind. There are others too, but this one kind of stood out for some reason. And it was that I didn't make the high school basketball team. And I tried out. I played for we called it B team back then, but didn't make the senior high team. And I remember going to the gym that day when they posted, the coach said, hey, the names of those who made the team will be posted on the gym door. And classes got out, and I remember going over to the gym, and I walked up there, and my name wasn't on the list. And, man, I was deflated. I had been rejected by my coach. And, you know, it hurt. It really did hurt. I mean, there were a number of reasons that it hurt. But one of the things that I was most excited about, I'll tell you how long ago this was, I was most excited about was that if you got to play on the varsity team, then you would get brand new Adidas tennis shoes that were white with the three black stripes. These were the originals. If I had them today, you know how much they'd be worth. And I was looking forward to getting those shoes. I didn't get them because I didn't make the team. And my mother and daddy weren't going to go out and buy me some just for the heck of it, you know. I was rejected. You ever been rejected? I was thinking about Devin last week. If you remember me talking about Devin and the story that was a true story about him last week and how he lost his ranch to his ex-wife and how the lawyer who represented her in the divorce ended up shacking up with her in the ranch. It should have been Devin's. Remember all that last week? And his struggle with unforgiveness. But what about his struggle with rejection by his ex-wife? I mean, you know, rejection, it's one of these things that once it gets a hold of us, it's kind of like something that just grows and it seems to get bigger and bigger. It's one of the most hurtful things in life. Rejection is. So the sting of rejection can linger for some people a long time. Here's some examples. A spouse leaves us, or we get fired from our job, or we get snubbed by our friends, or ostracized by our family or our community, the folks we hang out with. Or we're rejected by a parent, or a boyfriend, or a girlfriend, or maybe even a teacher at some point in our life. That pain can be absolutely paralyzing. Because when you're rejected, nothing in the moment hurts worse, and it just seems to linger. I was reminded of the TV show Survivor. Anybody ever watch Survivor? Debbie's parents still watch it. Quit watching a while back. But you remember, it's like they voted you off the island. It's like everybody else got together, and they went up there with a secret ballot, and they voted you off the island, and so you have been rejected. And that's the way you kind of feel sometimes when these things happen to us, because we want acceptance more than anything else in life. We want to be accepted by our parents. We want to be accepted by our peers. We want to have the respect of those that we look up to and even those that we don't look up to. In fact, we even want to be accepted by those that we don't even like. It's true. It's true. Rejection is so painful, and many of us have experienced it. In fact, I would dare to say all of us have. Here's what it means. Rejection means this. Listen, just the definition hurts, just to read it. Listen. To discard or throw out as worthless, useless, or substandard, to cast off or to cut off. I mean, it's like we're just throwing you out. You're worthless, useless, or the worst one, substandard. You don't live up to what everybody else is doing. So we spend most of our lives doing everything we can to avoid being rejected. We buy things that we don't need with money that we don't have to impress people that we don't know. It's true. Because this need to be accepted is so profound that it seems to drive everything that we do. This is a serious one. And the question I ask is, why is that? I mean, why are we so bothered when some of our friends don't like our Facebook post, for those of us who are still on Facebook? It's like, what happened? What was wrong with my post? And you're my friend, and you didn't like my post? I mean, why would something so seemingly insignificant make us angry or ruin our day? Or even make us feel bad about ourselves? There must have been something wrong with my post. There must have been something I did yesterday. What is it? Why are they rejecting me? So you heard a little bit about this from our reporter, Patrick. Why does rejection hurt so bad? He mentioned that there are actually MRI studies. These are medical studies that prove that the area of our brain that reacts to rejection is the same area of our brain that reacts to physical pain, like hurting your arm or, you know, stepping on a nail, whatever it may be. It's the same areas of the brain. And so that's one of the reasons that rejection hurts so bad. But there was another study, other studies, in fact, multiple studies, that teach us that rejection actually temporarily lowers your IQ. Here's how we know. Because they brought some folks in and they set them up with IQ testing. And here's what they did. They had them recall an event in their life, an experience in their life when they were rejected just before they took the test. And when they did, they actually scored lower on that test than they had scored on previous tests. I mean, not only IQ test, it also occurs when they did tests of short-term memory. It affected that. And it affected, the third testing was of decision-making. So when we're reeling from the pain of rejection, we just aren't capable of thinking clearly. But there are other ways this particular toxin of rejection impacts us. And here's one of them. It creates surges in us of anger and aggression. Surgeon General, a few years ago, issued a report stating that rejection was a greater risk for adolescents' violence than drugs, poverty, or gang membership. That's significant. In fact, there are countless studies that have demonstrated that even a mild rejection, one little simple rejection, could lead people to aggression over innocent bystanders. Makes sense. Think about it. I mean, what do we find out often about someone who walks into a school and begins to shoot it up? They've been rejected by their teachers or by their fellow students. Or those who walk into a business and they take out aggression by shooting others. It's usually because they've been fired or they had some kind of rejection by someone else at the place of employment. I mean, it's pretty clear. Why is there so much violence in the States and around the world against women? Same kind of thing. People take out their aggression because they've been rejected. So that's a medical reality. That's why this one is so significant today as we think about it. Because rejection does something even greater, and there's a bigger place of danger. And here's where it is. It's on the inside of us. It's in our understanding of who we are. It's in our spirit. It's in our countenance. We become intensely self-critical when we're rejected. You ever been there? We call ourselves names sometimes. Man, I'm just stupid. I was just stupid. What was I thinking? We lament our shortcomings, you know. I can't believe I can't do that. I mean, you know, that's just, I tried, but I just couldn't do it. And sometimes we even feel disgusted with ourselves. We just don't even like ourselves. And maybe it started on the playground when you were picked last, or you weren't picked at all on the team, or maybe when you didn't get the date for the dance, or maybe when they didn't ask you to marry them, whatever it may be. And then we begin to be critical of ourselves, and we question our self-worth, because rejection is seated, S-E-A-T-E-D, seated in doubt. It's captured in that, encapsulated in doubt. Because rejection is a question. It's not a statement. It's a question. And here's the question that we often find ourselves asking. What's wrong with me? Why did they reject me? What's wrong with me? What did I do wrong? Why didn't I get picked? Why wasn't I part of it? And so there are these two voices in our head. And they war against each other. Especially if you're somebody who's been around the faith or you're a person of the faith. You hear this one voice saying these beautiful words like, I am accepted, I am beloved, I am loved by God, and I belong here with God. You hear that one voice. It's a beautiful voice. And then you hear this other voice, and it says something like this. No one really loves me. My family may pretend to. My friends just use me. And God, well, maybe he doesn't like me either. And that second voice, the one that doesn't come from God, just screams doubts in our ears every single time there's an incident of rejection. What's wrong with me? What's wrong with me? And that's where Satan lives. He loves to just pounce on that with the power of a lie. He takes hold of it and tries to convince us that there has to be something wrong. You're just not lovable. It's you. Man, aren't you glad you're here today? I mean, you know, it's hard. But here's the beauty of God and his love for us. Listen, he knows we're in those places, and he knows what rejection does to us. And so he says, I'm the healer. I can heal you of that if you'll let me. If you'll let me. And so what if we could truly see rejection recede? Now, I want you to hear this. When I talk about this, here's the thing about rejection. It can leave such deep-seated struggles and issues with self-worth that it's not often something that is healed instantaneously. It's going to take a process for most of us, but it can begin today. We were talking about this in our content meeting the other day, and I said, to recede, it kind of seems like it's like the tide going out slowly. You know, the tide at the ocean goes out, and then I think it was Brooks who said, well, maybe it's more like a sunrise that just very slowly dissipates the darkness with this beautiful light. And is it possible? I think it is. And here's the cure from the scripture. The cure is this. The cure for this toxin of rejection is the truth. What's the truth? And I want to start with just a couple of ideas. Here's the first one. This is absolute truth that you and I have heard all of our life, but have we really believed it? And it's this: God loves me. Write that one in. God loves me. That's at the heart of our faith. It's at the heart of our understanding of who God is. God really loves me. He really loves you. In fact, here's the beauty of it. God loves everybody. Isn't that good? I mean, that means the person who gets on your last nerve, God loves them just as much as he loves you. The person who pulls out in front of you on the way to church in the morning, believe it or not, God loves them just as much as he loves you. I have to tell myself that sometimes. Debbie and I'll be riding along, and there's that guy there, or girl that does that, and I'm like, and then I'll just stop, and I've said it a few times, Hannah, Debbie. I said, you know what? I know I'm mad, but God loves them just as much as he loves me. They're a child of God. Come on. And Debbie's like, that's right, Jimmy. You need to stop doing that. But it's true. He loves everybody. It doesn't matter how much money you have. It doesn't matter what you've accomplished in life. He loves the poorest person just as much as he loves the richest person. It doesn't matter how good or bad you've been. It doesn't matter if you have perfect attendance at church. And so when you run into somebody who messes your day, I just want to encourage you to messes up your day. Just remember this. God loves them just as much as he loves me. In fact, we know that from John 3:16. In fact, God says this through the scripture. For God so loved the world, it's everybody in it, that he gave his only son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have life everlasting. That's what he did. So he's loved you, and he's loved me, and he's loved everybody else. And listen, he loved you and me before you were born. He loved you and me before you even knew anything about him at all. He loved you. And he decided to do that a long time ago. That's what John says in his letters later on in the New Testament. 1 John 4:10 says this. This is love. He loved us long before we loved him. That's a long time. The beauty of that is he even knew what you and I would do in life. I mean, he even knew about the mistakes you and I would make. He even knew about, not mistakes, but the sin you and I would commit in our life. And he loved you anyway. Long before we loved him, it was his love, not ours. He proved it by sending his son to be the pleasing sacrificial offering to take away our sins. So God doesn't reject us. He doesn't reject anyone who comes to him. You know, some people say Christianity, well, I don't like Christianity because it's so exclusive. You know, these people, Christians claim that Jesus is the only way, and that's exclusive, and everybody ought to go to heaven, and everybody ought to be there, you know, and there are multiple ways to go. Well, listen. Number one, I believe the scripture is crystal clear about that, that Jesus is the way. But here's the thing, everybody's invited. There's no exclusion there. The only way we're excluded is if we exclude ourselves. But he says, all who come to me, all of you, have the right to be my children. So here's the reality, though. Not everybody's going to come to him. Not everybody will. Not everybody will love him and trust him. In fact, many reject him, but he will never, ever reject you. He will never, ever reject me if we come to him. So that's the first thing. God loves me. Here's the second one. God loves me, I want to add to that, and wants to adopt me, you, as his. Isn't that good? He wants us to be his. That's what he wants. That's why he created us, was that we might in some way find him and love him and follow him. Ephesians 1:5, the passage I read to start with, says, God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family. This is what he wanted to do. So he doesn't see us as rejected or something's wrong with us, even though the reality is there is something wrong with us, and that's that we're sinners. All of us are. The thing that's wrong with us is sin, but that's not what he sees. He sees us as his beloved who are delivered from sin. So healing begins when I start seeing me as God sees me. That's important. And I love a passage from Isaiah which tells us about how God sees us. Beautiful song that the choir sang at 8:55. You are mine. And so I want to read this to you. It's from the Message. Look what it says here. This is what God thinks about when he thinks about you. He says, but now, here's God's message, the God who made you in the first place, the one who got you started. That's true. He made you. Don't be afraid. I've redeemed you. I've delivered you. I've saved you. I'm the one who provides a way for you to be healed when it comes to things like shame and unforgiveness and rejection. I've redeemed you. I've made a way. I've called your name. You're mine. When you're in over your head, I'll be there with you. When you're in rough waters, you will not go down. When you're between a rock and a hard place, it won't be a dead end. Because I am God, your personal God, the Holy of Israel, your Savior. Look at the next part. I paid a huge price for you. That's how much you mean to me. That's how much I love you. I'd sell off the whole world to get you back, trade the creation just for you. So don't be afraid. I'm with you. Man, you need to cut that out and hold on to it. That is beautiful. And it's true. That's truth. And truth is going to help us overcome rejection. That's how God sees you. That's what he thinks about. So he wants us to know that he's made a claim to us and we are his. And all he wants from us is for us to make a claim to him and be his. He loves us and he wants to adopt us. And here's the third one. This is an essential piece to it. And this is that my adoption comes through Jesus Christ. I can't get there without him. I can't say, you know, just adopt me just because. I have to go through Jesus Christ. That's what it said in Ephesians 1:5. It says, God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. That's the route. That's the way. So the first step to this healing process that we are hoping that God will allow us to experience is to be adopted, and that requires surrender. It takes us surrendering to him in order to be adopted. It requires action on our part for this to happen. And we know that means we got to give our life to him. Here's what I want you to know. And this isn't Jimmy. I think this is definitely what the Lord is trying to say to us today. Listen, all of these things that we're talking about in this series, they're going to be with us forever unless we surrender to Christ. Unless we give our life to him, truly give our life to him, we're going to deal with this for the rest of our life. And not only that, listen, if you have children and you have grandchildren, if you're not passing on to them this same truth, listen, they're going to grow up and they're going to deal with it too. And that's not fair. Because there's a way. And they can be free of it. All we have to do is tell them the way. We've got to just do what we do here at Park Avenue. I just got to get people a little bit closer to Christ, because if I get them a little bit closer to Christ, his love's going to take care of it all. So it's important that that's what we have to do. The first step is to surrender. But it's going to take a while to get over the pain of rejection. Just as that ocean recedes, healing from rejection is a process. It is. It's going to take a while. Devin, the one that I mentioned last week and mentioned a little bit today, Devin was able finally to get over his unforgiveness. True story, in the book that I've been studying for this series, Devin was able to do it. Devin was able to get over the rejection of his ex-wife. But it was a process. It was a process, and it started with his relationship with Christ. This process involves, in that relationship, learning to trust Jesus, not humanity. I'm going to trust Jesus Christ. Trusting the one who chose me, who accepted me, and wants to adopt me. And here's the reality. The better I get at trusting Jesus, the better and the sooner I'm going to have healing from rejection. It's going to happen. Here's the beauty of it all. If anyone knows what it feels like to be rejected, it was Jesus Christ, right? Jesus understood that. You know, I love that John, in his gospel, in the prologue, in John chapter 1, verse 11, says this. He's talking about Jesus. He says he came to his own, meaning his own people. He came to the people that he had actually created. And he came as a Jew, so he even came to the Jews. He came to his own people. You hear that? But look what else it says. And his own people did not accept him. I don't love the fact that it says they didn't accept him. What I love is the fact that that didn't deter him from doing what he came to do. I mean, Jesus was despised. He was rejected. Even his closest friends, those disciples gathered around him. The Bible tells us that every single one of them, not just Peter, deserted him when he was arrested. You want to talk about being rejected? Jesus understood that. He knows what you and I have felt when we have been rejected. But it didn't stop him. Despite that, he still was willing to die for those who rejected him. He was willing to go to a cross. And that rejection would come to an excruciating climax on Good Friday when they nailed him to a cross and spit on him and made fun of him and then took a spear and drove it into his side. And he died for those who rejected him. You see, here's the thing about the cross. That cross is the ultimate sign of redemption. That's what it's all about. A way to never be rejected again, to be loved and to be adopted. It's right there at the cross. That's the reason he went there. You don't have to worry about humanity and rejection here because he's accepted you and he made the way on the cross, the way of redemption, the way of acceptance. So we can trust God because of what happened on the cross. It was for you, and it was for me. There at the cross, God's opinion of us stands fully revealed. And here's what it says. You and I are of infinite value to him. Isn't that beautiful? I hope you're hearing and receiving that. So maybe all your life, you've believed the lie of who you are and what you are worth. The lie Satan's been telling you, there's something wrong with you. You're not good. You're not accepted. How come you're not in there? There must be something wrong. That's a lie. That's a lie. If that's you and you believe that and you haven't yet healed from it, then here's what I want to encourage you to do today. Look at the cross. Look at the cross. It's the only place in all the universe where you'll find the truth about yourself. Jesus died for you. And I love what somebody said. Somebody said, if you were the only person to ever walk this earth, he would still die for you and you alone. And so the prescription for better eyesight here with this rejection is to actually reject the lie. There's where the rejection needs to come. We reject Satan, rebuke Satan, reject the lie, and believe the truth, that God will never reject you. Parents might. In fact, the scripture tells us, can a mother forget her nursing baby? And he says, even if they do, I will not forget you. I will not forsake you. Spouses can. Friends will. Bosses too. But not God. Never. He wants you and is willing to adopt you as his own. I know we probably have some folks in here who've been adopted. And I wish I had time for you to share your story. But I saw a video clip not too long ago on TV about an 11-year-old girl who found out that she was being adopted. And her teacher, one of her teacher's counselors, tells her about it. Remember that video? Watch this video of an 11-year-old girl being adopted.
It must be the happiest moment in this little girl's life.
I felt like a million, jillion things just exploded in my heart.
11-year-old Tana Butterfield couldn't contain her excitement after learning she was getting adopted.
I feel so happy. Like, this is like the best thing that's ever happened to me.
When the judge formally approved the adoption, they asked Jackie Alexander, an office manager at American Heritage School, to relay the joyous news.
I grabbed her by her shoulders and I just said, "Baby, have you heard the news? Everything went great today in court. Good news, you get your forever family." I cried every time I watched the video. I cry every time I get a message from somebody saying that they needed to see that video. They needed some light in their day.
Now, Tana is looking forward to a happy life with her forever family.
I know they're safe people, and I know that they love me, and I know that they'll always be there for me, and I just love them.
Wow. Isn't that beautiful? And so that's what it should feel like for us, to know that God wants to adopt us and that we are His. And so I was thinking about it. Every time that you are rejected or you feel rejected, here's what you ought to do. When you sense that feeling of rejection and the hurt and the pain that's wherever it is in your brain and working through that MRI and all that other stuff in your heart and everywhere, here's what you ought to do. You ought to imagine yourself just running and jumping into Jesus' arms and just pulling your feet up like she did and just holding on to Him. And He's going to hold on to you. And you know what He's going to say? "You're my beloved. You're the one that is so precious to me. You're mine. You're my child. I'll never reject you." That's how He thinks about you. That's seeing myself the way He sees me heals the pain that we feel, you and I feel. And so I wanted to leave you with something concrete today to take with you. See this little thing? Did you see that? Pull that out for a minute with me. It's a reminder. And I probably, the one thing I probably should have done is in the background of this, just had a cross in the background of these words, because that's the centerpiece of it all. But a friend of ours gave this to us years ago, Dr. Edwin Chase, and I've held on to it and share it every now and then. But look with me at this. This is how God sees me. I want you to receive this. He made me in His image. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. I love this next one. My name is engraved on the palm of His hand. It's like every time He opens His hand, He sees your name. He sees my name. I am loved with an everlasting love. Everlasting means it never stops. It never runs out. It doesn't. It keeps going no matter what. I am worth delighting in. I am forgiven, praise God, and redeemed. Dear God, thank you. I am anointed. That means you're special and you have a purpose. You hear that? This is Scripture. This is God speaking through Scripture about you. I am beautiful. You hear that, Debbie? I'm beautiful. I want you to hear that one. I'm more than a conqueror. I'm not defeated. Rejection doesn't defeat me. Shame and unforgiveness, they don't defeat me. I'm a conqueror because of Christ and what He's done for me. I am chosen, holy, dearly beloved, dearly loved. I am God's handiwork. I am worth fighting for. He will fight for you. I am His beloved child. He rejoices over me with singing. He sent His Son to die for me. That's what He thinks about you. And His question is to me, and maybe it's to you too today, when are you going to believe that? When are you going to believe it? Well, maybe today's the day. Maybe today's the day healing starts. So here's some next steps for you to think about this week. The first one is this. I'm going to believe it. I'm going to believe that He really loves me. Second, I'm going to reject Satan's lie that I am no good. You know, that needs to stop. You need to stop hearing that voice. And one of the ways that you do that is when you hear that voice, you cling to Jesus, but you also rebuke Satan. He has no authority over you. If you are in Christ, he has no power over you, but he's going to try. And you just tell him, stop. That is not who I am. And then the third one, I will trust God. The more you trust God every single day, the better the chances are that you're going to heal sooner and more fully. And then the last one is the most important. Today, for the first time, I surrender my life to Christ to be adopted as his child. If you haven't done that, that's the first step. And so God loves us so much that he gives us the way to be healed of these things that strike at the heart. And I'm so grateful. Let's pray if we could. Father, thank you so much that not only did you provide a way for us to be redeemed from our sin, to be delivered from our sin, to be made righteous because of Christ's death on the cross, but you provided a way for us to be healed in this life of the things that weigh us down and hold us back. And that's through Jesus Christ. God, my prayer for all of us today is that we would understand better the depth of your love for us, and that we might respond to that, trusting you and knowing that you're not ever going to reject us. Instead, you want us to be your sons and daughters. What a gift that is. So help us to live into that truth and reject the lie and be made whole through Jesus Christ. That's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
As usual, we want to give you time to respond and think and pray by yourself as a family. Altars are always open. We ask you to stand and sing and bask in the beauty of the words of the song. His love for us, what it means to him. Just use this time to draw close to him.
Come on, sing that out.
And oh,
son.
Listen, I hope that hello, try it again. That you feel loved today, because you are loved. Not only are you loved by God, listen, you're loved by the staff, Jamie and I, your pastors. We love you, and so does God. So listen, live into that love. That's the truth. You're not rejected. You're accepted. And may God build that into you this week in such a way that you share it with others. Go in peace. God bless you. We love you.